Hey, what's up, guys? It's October 2nd, and we just had a hurricane pass through, so I figured today would be a great day to give you a full review and demo ride of the Conch 27. One thing that's always really bothered me is people try to do boat reviews when it's flat calm out, and to me that's kind of a joke, because even a John boat rides good when it's flat calm out. So we have gust up to about 35 knots out of northeast today, so I figured it'd be a good day to test out and see how good the Conch 27 really performs. I'm gonna start by showing you the exterior of the boat. So you can see we have it sitting on this beautiful rock and roll trailers. Really happy with this trailer. It's a bunk trailer. It seems like they use real high quality components, stainless steel, hardware. It's a tandem axle trailer. It's rated for 10,400 pounds, which is overrated. This hull weighs 4,400 pounds dry. Now with the single 300 Suzuki on it, that's an extra 600 pounds, and plus fuel. One thing I will say about the fuel, it's supposed to hold 200 gallons, but from my experience, it has about 150 gallons of usable fuel. So I'm not sure if it just doesn't hold 200 or it doesn't pick up the 200, but that's about what I have for fuel, is 150 gallons. In the stern of the boat, the engine shroud, a lot of people ask questions about this. This makes a great fillet table. It encloses the transom, so if you are taking big seas in your stern, it stops water from coming in the boat. Also, it's really nice when it's rough out, when people are fishing off the back of the boat, they have something to lean against. It also gives you a workbench, rigging station, just a really great platform, and really utilizes space. Well, one thing that Conch does is they use the every square inch of the boat is thought out, and it's a usable space. The single 300, we're gonna run the boat in a little bit, and I'll get some numbers for you and show you the performance with the single 300. But this is probably the biggest boat that you could still get good performance with a single outboard, which is one thing that makes this boat so impressive. It does have a 22 degree dead rise, which is gonna give you the right combination of a good ride and still provide stability at drift. And the two Humminbird side imaging, down imaging transducers, one on each side of the engine, that eliminates any engine interference, which really gives you a perfect side imaging reading. Start in the bow and work our way to the stern. So starting at the bow, I have my Minn Kota trolling motor. Now this is a 72 inch Ulterra. I also have an 87 inch Tarova. Both work well. One of the nice things about the Conch is the bow to the waterline isn't that high, so this 72 inch will still work pretty good. I would imagine if you were trying to use it in really, really rough seas, you might cavitate, but for most of the fishing I do, the 72 is fine. I do have an 87, which is definitely going to give you more than enough, but it's nice that I have the option to run the 72 on this boat. The anchor locker right here opens flat. There's a nice anchor holder there for a Danforth anchor, and you hold plenty of rope in there, a lot of space in there, and I have a plug for the Minn Kota, so I'm able to change the motor out if need be, and a quick release bracket as well. For the gunnels, I put this Aqua Traction cushion, which is really nice. It's 3/4 inch, really gives you something nice to lean against, just makes it a little bit more comfortable. Gunnel height in the front of the boat, really nice here. It's just above knee level, like lower thigh for me, and I'm 6 foot tall, so it provides security, so when you're in rough seas you have something to lean against. Doesn't have a wall in here, so you're able to put your toes right against it, which is really important if you fish in different boats where you can't get against the gunnel. It really is tough to fish, but this boat fishes really well in rough seas. Here I have two pitch wells, so these just fill up with a bucket. You use this little plug, just plug that up, and that's just if we're running from spot to spot, Reset our drifts. We just want a place to keep our baits while we reset the drifts, so you don't have them out of the water. You're not killing your bait, so it gives you something to have the bait ready when you reset your drift. I did go ahead and put some gunnel rod holders, so I have one up front and three more in the back here. May add another one or two, but that covers most of what we do. That's plenty of rod holders. The big fish box or bow locker here, so we'll open this up. I probably will put a pair of shocks on this just to make it a little easier to close, but this is massive. I mean, you could literally lay down inside of this. This would obviously, if you were giant tuna fishing, you could use this as a fish box. It does have a drain plug in there, which would drain into the bilge. Since I don't do any giant tuna fishing, I just use it for storage. So I have my life jackets, extra cast nets, buckets, a couple little extra items in there. And it's nice to have a big hatch in the floor like this. Now, obviously, you can see the bow of this boat. You have a ton of room. I mean, it is really just awesome how open the front of this boat is. So right here, looking at the console, I have a 65 quart Yeti cooler against the console, and right here is our forward live well. This isn't my primary live well. I use the stern one more just for logistical purposes, but this is an absolutely enormous live well. This is 110 gallons. You can really fit a tremendous amount of bait in there. You can see in here there's two overflows on each side and your intake right there and the day drain, which this does drain out into the bilge. Some people did have questions or concerns about that. Personally, I don't see an issue with it. You drain all your water. There's two bilge pumps. It flushes the bilge out, keeps it clean, and all that water gets pumped out by the bilge. So if anything, I think it helps keep the bilge cleaner. right here, we have additional storage. This actually goes pretty far up. It probably runs up about 6 feet, so you can really fit a lot of stuff in there. Usually I have my clients store their stuff in here. All the hatches in the boat, with the exception of the anchor locker, do have friction hinges. These are Gemlux, so it's nice because this doesn't really slam. You kind of have to push it down. I did go ahead and install one of the things that I didn't like about it, but one of the few things I didn't like was this drain gutter is fairly narrow, so it's a little tough to plumb this. I did find a half inch to 3/4 inch drain, and this drains out, and I think eventually I want to actually run that through that that stringer there and actually get that so the water will just drain right into the bilge area. But that's what I did. I probably could add another one, but that does a decent job of getting the water to drain through so it doesn't end up going on your stuff in there. And on this side, this is just a duplicate of the other side. I have extra tackle. This is, you know, spare tackle, stuff that I'm not using on a regular basis. So got a lot of room in there for extra stuff. I'm gonna show you inside the console. I'm gonna move the Yeti cooler out of the way. You do have to move the cooler to open up the console, but I did wanna have enough space for the cooler. I think we went 16 inches from the console to this bow live well. This way I could access that live well without having to move the cooler out of the way, which is obviously really convenient. All right, here's inside the console. Now these shocks open this door up about halfway, which is a little bit of a pain when you have to get in there. It would be nice to have it open all the way, but this was done so it doesn't, if you ever open this, it doesn't block the view of the driver, but obviously you wouldn't be opening up your console door when you're running the boat anyways. It's really a lot of room in here. This actually goes back about 7 or 8 feet back, so you really have a lot of room in this console. You could stand up in the console. I'm sure you've seen my other videos. This is all the rigging I did here. Battery switch, fuse panels. You can see the backs of the electronics, Ethernet box. I'm really happy with how neat and clean all this wiring came out.
the trolling motor batteries. I have the three Dakota Lithium batteries. These batteries have been awesome. They never run out of juice, and this is us doing 3 5-hour trips a day, so we're on the water for 15 hours, and those batteries don't lose juice. We've never had the trolling motor go out of power. So, and then they're hooked up to this. This is a 5-bank Minn Kota precision charger. You can see the plug is on the other side of the console, so you just plug into that every day, and that charges all our batteries. And it's nice because it does do the lithiums and the lead acid. Because for our house battery and starting battery right there, I have two traditional lead acid batteries. So with that charger, you just select the battery type, and you can charge both lithium and lead acid batteries, which is really nice. Then in the console, I just keep some safety equipment, paperwork, have some extra tackle in there as well, a little toolbox, so it gives you, there's plenty of room. There's a spare prop in the back as well. I always keep a spare prop that's tucked away in the back. We're gonna go out of the console now and show you the rest. All right, so with the T-top, I get a lot of questions and comments about the T-top. I did do a very short T-top. In my opinion, I think most T-tops are made way too big for boats, and they just interfere with your casting and fishing ability. So I wanted this top to stop right in line with the, you know, about a quarter of the way up the leaning post, just to give you, you the driver and the passenger, a little bit of some protection and coverage if it's raining, but I don't want it interfering. I could still fish from the helm and cast over my left shoulder if I'm fishing the port side, or off my over my right shoulder if I'm fishing off the starboard side, and I won't interfere with the T-top. Here we did do a piece of, this isn't isinglass, it's a bit thicker, it's a 60 gauge material. It doesn't rattle around, which I really like. It's very clear and visible. I didn't want to do a three-sided enclosure because I feel like it just restricts your visibility. This stays really clear. Sometimes in the morning, if it's dewy out, it will fog up and you just wipe it down with a little absorber. But for the rest of the day, this is super clear. And again, with the T-top, I didn't want to overhang. I wanted to the T-top to be in line with the front of the console. So when somebody's fishing in the bow, they don't have to worry about catching and whacking the T-top, which you'll see a lot of people do with oversized T-tops. And this is the width of the console. So I was able to put 6 rod holders on each side of the console, so I could carry a dozen rods on the console in the center of the boat, and the rods don't interfere with the T-top. And then up top, I mounted my Hummingbird Chirp radar, VHF antenna, the white all-around light, and our red and green navigation lights, which is really nice to have the lights up there. Doesn't restrict your visibility at night. Looking at the console, I have 2 really impressive 16-inch Hummingbird Apex screens. These screens are incredible. The clarity is the best I've ever seen, and the side imaging is truly unmatched. It really is the best side imaging. You will find fish that you would never see with traditional sonar. Also have the Hummingbird heading sensor, so that's a GPS heading sensor, so you get real accurate, precise GPS heading. Compass, couple little C-deck trays for storage, VHF antenna, this new wire marine switch panel. I'm really happy with this. It does have indicator lights, which is really nice, so you know if the switch is on, it prevents you from leaving a pump on and burning it out. Also resettable breakers, and I went with the red lights because these don't blind you at night. Some of the other colors, like, they have really bright blue ones that would just kill your night vision. 12 volt or I should say a USB charger right there for charging up your remote and your phone. The Suzuki digital flyby wire is very precise. Suzuki gauge right here, and you can obviously see our helm pod with our undermount helm and steering wheel. Right here, I put 8 plano box holder, which is really nice to be able to access as I'm fishing. I really don't like leaving the helm when I need to get
gear out, change lures, change terminal gear. So this makes that really easy, and I'm still always in view of my electronics. I know where the boat is at all times. And right here for the Minn Kota 5-bank battery charger, just plug in right there at the end of the day and charge your batteries up. Moving on to our leaning post. This is the Birds All Marine leaning post. It does have a foldable footrest right here. It's nice that it fits this igloo cooler. I could fit, I use this as my kill box. So this is 94 quart igloo cooler. I could fit all the fish that we're gonna be keeping to eat right in there and then wash it out when we're done. This leaning post does fold forward, which is really nice. So I could keep a lot of my gear, my sinkers, and whatever I need quick access to, I keep in here. Again, I'm all about not leaving the helm when I'm re-rigging and retying stuff. In the back here, we have four rod holders, which is really nice, two cup holders and a little rigging station and a railing for people to grab onto right here. So really convenient leaning post. In the midship, I put my saltwater washdown hose so I could wash down the bow and stern of the boat. I have a small gaff holder right there, and I did put two pairs of horizontal rod holders on both sides of the boat for extra rod storage. In the stern here, we have a big open area to fish. There's about 4 feet from the back of the leaning post to the shroud, so it gives you a lot of room here. The gunwale height is right below my kneecap right here, which is really nice. Great for fishing. Not having the high gunwales makes it much easier to reach the water line. It makes it a lot easier to land fish. When you're throwing cast nets, you really want those low gunwales. This makes it so much better to throw cast nets off the stern of the boat and also haul in when you get a big load of bait in your net. I did put a little ruler right by the kill box so we could quickly measure fish that we're going to be keeping. And right here, this is the main live well that I use on a regular basis. Again, massive live well. This is 90 gallon live well, two overflows and one intake, and this is really impressive. I could put about 80 adult menhaden in here and they will live very well. It's the best live well I've ever fished with in terms of keeping your bait quality really high. This is a great live well, and also because it's such a big opening, makes it so much easier to just dump your bait in there with your cast net, not have to pick them up off the floor and get have them, you know, kicking around on the deck of the boat. Back here is the bilge. So right here, I did put a ball valve so I could control the flow into the live well. And if we're not running a live well, I could close it right up and still be able to use my washdown hose because the washdown comes through this one seacock. So I have one seacock for my stern live well and my washdown pump right there. That's a Jabsco washdown pump. And right here, if I'm using the bow live well, I have a separate seacock for that. I did put big seacocks in. Those are 1.5-inch seacocks. You get a lot of water flow. When I'm not using the bow live well, obviously that seacock would be closed. And here I have two rural 2,000 gallon per hour bilge pumps with float switches. And right here is my fuel water separator with little ball valves to control the flow, because I am running a single outboard with two tanks. Now this boat has two saddle tanks, so the fuel tanks are right in the midship on both sides of the console. So you want to try to control that flow rate and keep both tanks draining evenly so the boat doesn't start to list to one side. That's why those ball valves are there. For some reason, the port tank will drain first. So usually what I have to do is either pinch that line or I'll alternate tanks to just keep closing one tank for half the day, and then, you know, switch that tank open and close the other one the second half of the day. And the port and starboard hatches we have here for additional storage. Right here, I usually just throw my fenders, the lines in there, and then on the port side right here, it's the same thing, good amount of storage, cast net, buckets, Ziploc bags in there. So as you can see, the 27 Conch, in my opinion, for a 27 foot boat, this offers a best in class in terms of storage, live well capacity by far. I don't think there's anything remotely close to it. The gunwale height is what I want to be fishing on. As I like to say, it feels like you get the benefits of fishing in an inshore boat with the lower gunwale heights, but the ride and stability of a much larger boat. So I really like the layout. Flat deck, open deck, ample amount of room for fishing in the bow and the stern. And now we're going to go ahead and put this boat in the water and see how she performs in some rough conditions.